This is Resonance 104.4 FM. Flippin' marvellous. How are you? Tis I, Nicholas of Hennegan, coming at you with yet another slice of literary London. Yeah, it's been a while. I don't know when you're listening to this, but we've just finished our August summer break, really. I hope you had a nice time. Did you have a good summer? Nice, relaxing? No, I didn't either. It was, of course, taken up with the glory and the agony that is the Edinburgh International Festival. And there will be more about that later. Oh, yes, there will. Of course there will. I spent the entire summer there worrying about whether anyone's going to turn up and see the play. The play, by the way, was Winston and David. Thank you for asking. Yes. Winston and David, about Winston Churchill and David Lloyd George, actually written by Lloyd George's great-great-grandson, the lovely Robert Lloyd George. Nice chap. And yeah, we were at the Underbelly for the whole of August. It was one of those situations where, I don't know if you're, I know you might be a writer, I know we have a lot of writers listening, and with plays it's slightly different because you need to put it in front of an audience. We had two nights at the brilliant Tabard Theatre, which is now reopened, Theatre at the Tabard in Chiswick, and that seemed to go very well, thanks chums who came. And then we went up to the Edinburgh Festival, which was sort of almost back to normal. The biggest open arts festival in the world. There were over 3,000 shows in the month of August, all sorts of disciplines, and as did rather well. Yes, thank you. We are going out touring, actually. It's going to be touring, and I think it's going to the USA as well. Gee whiz, holy, yeah, that's right. But more about that later, because I wanted to kick straight in with an annual event, and I think it's in its, I should have checked, shouldn't I, 8th year, 9th year, maybe 10th year, and it's from what I think the Times called arguably the most literary area of London, if not the world. Yes, I'm talking about Chiswick and the Chiswick Book Festival, organised by Torrin Douglas, who's a former journalist and a nice chap, and you will have heard Torrin talking many times about the festival on Literary London and on BohemianBritain.com, of course, our kind of sister podcast. And if you want to know any more, then just have a flick through me back catalogue, love, hey? Yes, you'll find quite a lot of talk with Torrin. And they have an annual event, which I really love. It's called the Local Writers Festival. And basically, well, local writers from the Chiswick area, as part of the Chiswick Book Festival, are invited along to the George IV pub, usually, the Boston Room, which is the big function room at the back, which I've put a couple of plays on there as well, actually. Nice place. And the idea is that you get 2 minutes to talk about your book. And it's supervised quite closely, and there is a horn that sounds if you go over your 2 minutes. So I sadly lost the first two writers due to, what shall we say, technical difficulties. I forgot to press the button. No, it's the first time in 22 years I've done that, so give me a break. Thank you. But we shall join the festival now, and it's in two parts. So enjoy hearing local writers talking about their loves, their lives, their writing. In just 2 minutes, part one of the Chiswick Book Festival.
Lovely. Next up, onto the stage, we have the wonderful, delightful Jo Pratt talking about her cookery books and, I think, particularly The Flexible Baker. Jo Pratt. Bread, tarts, tray bakes, cookies and desserts. That got your attention, didn't it? That's what I was asked to do. What is it? You like eating them or you like baking them? For me, it's both. This book, The Flexible Baker, is my 9th cookbook and 4th in the Flexible series. I've got The Flexible Vegetarian, Pescatarian, Family Food, and this is the 4th one. And really what you might be thinking is, what does flexible mean? Well, it doesn't mean you've got to do the downward dog and whisk your egg whites or do a full roll and roll out the pastry. Don't worry. Basically, it means that each and every recipe, they all have adaptable options, a flexibility for varying tastes, dietary requirements or lifestyle choices, covering everything from gluten-free, dairy-free, nut-free, egg-free, you name it. It's numerous choices. But at no point in time do I compromise on flavour in any of these recipes. There's over 75 recipes in here, each with a picture that I food-starved myself. They're tried and tested, the sweet and savoury. It was tested throughout COVID. I don't know if you remember, but there was a bit of a shortage of various ingredients, including flour, eggs, milk, you name it, all the ingredients that we need for baking. However, I managed it, and I got there, and I got the book out. It was an experience, I have to say, but I'm really pleased with the end result. There's a really handy store cupboard, sort of tips at the front on what you need to have if you want to be a flexible baker. There's a brilliant section at the back, which is a dietary index, really, which allows the reader to see where they can turn to if they need to have a certain dietary requirement that they need to cook for. So, for example, you might have a friend that you want to cook a gluten-free birthday cake for. What do? You make a nice espresso and walnut layer cake. What about a nut-free, gluten-free tray bake for school? Banana and caramel tray bake with a caramel topping. There are so many choices. They are really, really never-ending. I'm so proud of this book. It's written, it's modern, it's inspirational. It's a book for now and for the future. Thank you. And please ring the horn.
Next up, talking about his book of short stories, The Thrillers, is the book's called Limb of Satan, and it is Simon Gompertz.
I don't want to give too much away. During the lockdown and the times between the different lockdowns, there were strange happenings, odd people turning up, and to be honest, a degree of exploitation and even bullying. Now, I'm not talking about the government, I'm talking about our community here, us and you. So you need to know about this. And luckily, if you read my book of short stories, you will find all the information that you need, and you'll meet the culprits. For instance, the estate agent who couldn't help stealing from his customers, or the man who blew up a signal box, or the mafia, how it works in Hammersmith, or the man who decided to create a museum dedicated solely to knives, and of course the people called Limb of Satan. Now, if any of you in those descriptions of the characters recognise yourselves and feel a little bit uncomfortable, rest assured, names have been changed and there's been a bit of development from the truth to the stories. But of course, you know all about storytelling. There's a wavy line between truth and fiction, and I would love it if you would follow me on my wavy line and see how you reacted to the lockdowns. It revealed a lot about us, didn't it? And it was such an important time, had such a profound effect on our lives and on our loved ones. It's an e-book, which means that it's really easy to get and it's really cheap. And I'll put, instead of the books over there, I'll put some cards down which tell you how to do it. Find out from it. It's called Limb of Satan.
Stance, by the way. That was pretty cool. Only on the stage. Well done. Now, considering this is a random order that our speakers are appearing in, we only have two Simons appearing this evening, and the next one is up next. So talking about his science book called Speech, we have Simon Prentice.
To remember The Naked Ape by Desmond Morris, which reminds us that beneath everything we're all still animals. Well, my book Speech, with the subtitle How Language Made Us Human, tells the other side of that story, focusing on what makes us so different. Just by shuffling a few noises in my mouth, I can take an idea from my head and put it to your head. You can do the same, and before we know it, we're all plugged into a world brain. And no other animal can do that. But the extraordinary thing is, we don't know how we can do it. Even Noam Chomsky doesn't. So my book begins with a radical proposal that perhaps the key to language is not some magic mutation in our heads, but simply the fact that words are digital. Now, I haven't got time to go into that in 2 minutes, you'll have to read the book. But language is not just a free lunch. It's maybe our most first and most important form of artificial intelligence, but there are downsides, the most damaging of which are the traps of culture, religion, and identity, which are the things that most separate us. So my book goes into that. It also talks about science and the wonders of science, but also the difficulties and the fact that we're now pushing up against the edge of our planet, but we have no functioning forum to discuss and decide what to do about that. So, who am I to be saying this? Well, I'm not an academic, but unlike many professors of linguistics, I've spent 40 years at the coalface of language as a translator and interpreter. So I know where the syntax is buried. But since, you don't have to take my word for it, since publishing my book last year, self-publishing, it's had praise from astonishingly people like Richard Dawkins, Steven Pinker, Matt Ridley, John Gribben, and even Desmond Morris himself. So I like to say we can't all be wrong, but you'll have to decide. So speech, how language may deceive.
Seconds to spare. Latecomer ladies and gentlemen at the door, there are some seats over here if you want to take them before the next speaker comes on. Or are you going to stay over there? You're going to stay over there. Okay. There's an interval coming up fairly soon. You're in the right place for the bar. Okay, next. talking about, I haven't said religion in the last little speech. We have Catherine Pepinster up next, talking about her new book, Defenders of the Faith.
People asked why I wanted to write this book, Defenders of the Faith, about the monarchy and religion. I have three reasons. First, the coins in your pocket. Take a look at the head side and you'll see they have Latin acronyms for Elizabeth, by the grace of God, Queen, Defender of the Faith. Why is God and being Defender of the Faith so important that they're on our coinage? Second, my 1967 Children's Encyclopedia with its Way We Live Now section. It all seems like ancient history. But one thing remains the same, the Queen. What's the belief that underpinned her reign of 70 years? And third, the whirligig of politics. Has there ever been such turmoil? Brexit, COVID, Ukraine, the cost of living, and number 10 has become a revolving door. But yesterday, as Boris stepped down and Truss stepped up, there was that constant presence, the Queen, receiving them and representing continuity amid the drama. If you watch The Crown, you might assume monarchy is just a soap opera, but it doesn't explain what makes the Queen tick. What's the monarchy about? What are the beliefs that underpin our system? You might think the answers lie in politics and the Constitution. My book explains they really lie in religion. I start my story with Henry VIII, the first defender of the faith. For hundreds of years, monarchy and religion in this country involved conflict, death, violence, marriage dramas, and divorce. Religion was used to assert national identity. Today, the story of monarchy might not seem so dramatic, but God's still part of the deal. And God will loom over the next coronation, which cannot surely be far off. How much he might still be part of that deal when Charles III is crowned, my book explains. So buy it and get ready for the event of the century.
Talking about his book Nazis on the Nile is Vivian Kingcross.
Thank you very much. I'm just trying to Can you hear me okay?
Yeah.
I've got a soft speaking voice when I'm scared to death. This book, Nazis on the Nile, tells the little-known story of how former Nazi and German military leaders, arms manufacturers and arms dealers played a secret part in building Egypt's military and security state in the Cold War. It shows how German specialists from the Third Reich helped build Egypt's new army and navy, along with the country's first rockets, missiles and fighter jets. The book covers events over the final years of King Farouk's reign and Colonel Gamal Abdel Nasser's nearly two decades as Egypt's leader following the 1952 revolution of the free officers. It spans the Arab-Israeli wars and includes the Suez Crisis of 1956, which closed the door on the British Empire. The book reveals where thousands of former servants of the Third Reich went after the war. It shows how special forces veterans trained Egypt's irregulars to fight the British in the Suez Canal zone, how they helped the Palestinian Fedayeen self-sacrifices to disrupt the new state of Israel, and how German experts took a direct hand in shaping both Egyptian hard and soft power in the Cold War in the Middle East. The book opens up many British government files and official records of the period and delves into secret CIA files released in the United States under the Nazi War Crimes Disclosure Act of 1998. This has taken me 3 years to research and write. In an August lead book review, The Spectator called Nazis on the Nile a chilling, punch-packing tale told with great aplomb. I have two review copies here, and there are two on the
review copies that are available this evening, but only two, so if you want one, you better get in there quick. Okay, next up, talking about her coaching book, 10 Pillars of Success, we have Josephine Perry.
What is success? Tonight it will be beating that horn. But when I wrote The 10 Pillars of Success, it was the final question I asked my interviewees. Dame Kelly Holmes says it wasn't winning her two Olympic gold medals, it was fulfilling her potential. Casper Berry, he was famous at 16 in 1990's show Biker Grove. He said that wasn't fame, contentment was success for him. Sean Conway, he's an adventurer. He has swum from Land's End to John O'Groats. He said it wasn't about doing the first or the furthest, it was about finding his own path. Damien Hall, he is an amazing record-breaking runner. But he said he finds success when he does it in line with his purpose. Bobby Holland-Hampton, he is a stuntman. He's doubled for James Bond and for Thor, and he thought success was fame and fortune until he had spinal surgery and got depression and realised it was about having friends and family that were by his side. Emma Wiggs, she is the current Paralympic, world, and European para canoe champion. But she says those don't matter to her. What matters is the journey to the start line and enjoying that journey. Maxine Peake, the actress, she thought it was having her name in lights. And then she said it's not. It's about getting to do something you love every day. And Sarah Pascoe, the comedian, she said, success is personal. And I agree. So I invite you tonight, think about what success means to you, and then go over there and buy the 10 Pillars of Success so you can make it happen. Thank you.
workshop on said Temperance of Success this Sunday. Hello, that's what it says, Sunday, 2 p.m. And there are still spaces available if anyone is inspired. So, next up, talking about their children's book, The Adventures of Captain Bobo, we have Richard Dijkstra and Kay Hutchinson.
My father was a ship's captain, my mother worked for the dry docks, and I worked in the ships every summer as a student. There were always wonderful characters, and there were funny incidents. I know there's a lot of animals coming up on my mind. And plenty of stories to tell. But believe it or not, the Captain Bobo books are based on real life. This is my co-author, Richard, and together we write picture books based on a captain, his crew, and their comic adventures on board a famous paddle steamer. Storms and shipwrecks, mishaps and mice, and sweet illustrations bringing everything to life. And the paddle steamer, oh, I'm slightly out of sync, and upside down. But the paddle steamer is actually based on a real ship. The Waverley, the world's last ocean-going paddle steamer, is actually returning to the Thames and Tower Bridge in just a few weeks' time.
So our latest book in the series is actually called London, and it tells the story of with the crew going on a day's sightseeing before setting off for an evening cruise. But they discover that there's a problem because Tower Bridge won't open. And it's left to Emma, the apprentice engineer, to come up with a plan to save the day. Now, the Captain Bobo books have actually been a series on the radio. In 2020, they were a 10-part series. It was narrated by the late, great John Sessions. He absolutely loved the books. I told the BBC at the time that they were wonderful little sweet stories, and he hoped that, you know, life, why couldn't life be like Captain Bobo? The only other thing to say is, if you speak Gaelic, they're also available in Gaelic.
No next year when he asks to come up. Now then, last up before the interval, so get ready to charge your glasses or maybe charge to the bar. We have, talking about his sci-fi novel, Sons of Sol, Kevin McNally.
Anthony Smith and Percival Prendergast, two lads from the opposite side of the tracks and genius graduates of the Edinburgh Space Propulsion Laboratory and Academy, have invented a new space engine that will revolutionise travel and trade between the six colonies and beyond. An invention which will do a great deal of good for humanity and also be very lucrative to boot. A lot of people are interested, but a few do not want to pay. And so en route to their new jobs at the Sabra Engineering Works on the Moon, they find themselves abducted from the Gagarin Space Station by a glamorous but unscrupulous bounty hunter. She's gorgeous. From then on, our two characters, Smith and Prendergast, are involved in a hazardous cat and mouse chase across the solar system. Will they become the gazillionaires that Smith wants them to be, or the saviors of humanity that Prendergast wants them to be? Will they be thrown into a Centauran jail? Will they be pressed into forced labor on one of the smaller asteroids? Will they be blasted into space by ruthless space traders, or worst of all, will they be forced to aid and abet the evil battle cruiser commander Zoltak and his dastardly plan to take over the Earth. Only space and time will tell. Thank you. Now, I've left myself 30 seconds for questions before I get the horn. Thank you very much.
Brilliant, yes, what a way to end the first half. Kevin McNally there, of course, the famous actor, who is going to be talking to us soon. I'm going to fix it up in a couple of weeks' time. We're going to have a chat about his new book and, well, himself, really, and being a Chiswick artist and having appeared in Pirates of the Caribbean. And it was fairly prophetic, as you may imagine, some of the books and the comments that were made when this was recorded, which was, of course, before the sad news of the passing of Queen Elizabeth II. Depending on when you're listening to this, of course, it will all be over now. The Book Festival, the Chiswick Book Festival, as a mark of respect, decided to dedicate themselves to Her Majesty, which was quite a nice thing to do. And it was quite a strange time, wasn't it? I found myself getting very unexpectedly emotional. I was in a pub, oh yes, in the West End. And a Japanese TV crew came up and said to me after, it was after King Charles had given his first speech, two things that struck me. One was it was the first time ever I've been in a busy British pub and the whole pub stopped talking and it was silent and everyone focused on King Charles III. I have to get used to saying that, doing his first speech to the nation on that day. And the second thing was when this Japanese news crew said, "What do you think of it all?" I suddenly started blubbing almost. I got really emotional. And I'm not sure, I don't think it was so much the Queen Elizabeth thing. It was the fact that Queen Elizabeth II and my mum were born on the same year. And my mum only managed 72 years. And of course, the Queen did considerably better. And I don't deny that. I mean, it was fantastic. But it just suddenly, yes, I had this strange wave of emotion. And I gather one or two people have been similarly affected. But hey, we'll keep our uppers stiff, won't we? Yes, we will. And God bless her. It was a fantastic reign, and certainly growing up on a council estate in Birmingham in the 60s and 70s, there was very much a sympathy for the Queen. Not particularly being a royalist either way, there was a lot of appreciation, I think. It's probably the nicest way of putting it. So that was part one of the Chiswick Book Festival dedicated to Her Majesty Queen Elizabeth II, who passed away during the festival. And there will be part two. Do you know what? I might even do it next week. How's about that? Yes. So if you'd like to get in touch, as always, you can get me probably easiest to email radio@mavericktheatre.co.uk. Don't forget to check out bohemianbritain.com, which is now amassing thousands of views. A lot of Americans for some strange reason. So hello, America. So bohemianbritain.com. Yeah. Okay. And we'll probably play part two of the Chiswick Writers Book Festival, and we'll do that next time. All right. Have a great week. Thank you very much for your company. I'll see you again soon. I'm Nick Hennegan. This is Literary London on Resonance 104.4 FM.